On September 13th, 1978, Cheryl Bradshaw excitedly stepped onto the set of The Dating Game. After she asked her questions and heard the men's responses, her episode had come to a close and it was time for her to choose the lucky date to be. She chose bachelor number one, Rodney Alcala. Rodney and Cheryl chatted backstage that day, and despite the fact that he offered her a date she'd never forget, she said she started to get a feeling that he was off and turned down the offer. That burst of intuition would probably save her life that day, because by that point, no one had known that Rodney had already taken the lives of multiple women and would soon strike again. Had the dating show done any sort of a background check, they would have seen that Rodney had already spent 3 years in prison for striking a child. The other bachelors that day described the man as good looking, but a little quiet and creepy. They said he wouldn't really make eye contact with anyone either. But on stage, however, Rodney laughed and joked with his fellow bachelors. He was charming, intelligent, quick-witted, which is what ultimately won Cheryl over. After Cheryl rejected Rodney, it only fueled his fire. By the time he was finally caught, he claimed to have slain between 50 to 100 people. But like all the great FBI profilers do, to understand Rodney Alcala, we'll have to go back to the beginning. Rodney was born in Texas in 1943, and when he was 8 years old, his dad moved the family to Mexico, only to abandon them there 3 years later. So we've got childhood neglect. That checks out. When Rodney was 17, he joined the army as a clerk, but he had a nervous breakdown and was medically discharged. So he hitchhiked all the way back to his mother's house. After that, he was diagnosed with a list of mental disorders, including antisocial personality disorder, narcissism, borderline personality disorder, and psychopathy. As FBI profiler Jim Clements said, genetics loads the weapon, their personality and psychology aim it, but it's their experiences that pull the trigger. Rodney went on to attend UCLA and got a degree in fine arts, and even later studied film under Roman Polanski at New York University. That's right. Please welcome to the stage everyone's least favorite fugitive from the US criminal justice system. You know him from the Manson case. It's Roman Polanski. And in 1969, at the age of 34, Rodney would commit the first of his many copious crimes when he lured an 8-year-old girl into his van. Tali Shapiro was walking to school in Hollywood when Rodney told her he was a friend of her parents and offered her a ride. Right after she got in, he said he had a photo to show her, so he took her to his apartment and her memory went black after he bonked her with a pipe. And there are a lot of horrible details that are a very specific part of Rodney's MO that we'll be omitting. But it doesn't take a profiler to know that pretty much the worst things you can think of were Rodney's favorite things to do. Tali was within an inch of her life, but thanks to a passerby who reported a tip to the police, Rodney fled the scene and she was saved. After that, Rodney remained a fugitive for years. He lived in New York and lived under the fake name of John Berger. In 1971, Rodney took a job as a counselor at a New Hampshire arts camp for children. In June of that same year, the body of Cornelia Michelle Crilly, a 23-year-old flight attendant, was found in her Manhattan apartment. Her case remained unsolved until 2011, when two children who attended the arts camp recognized Rodney from an FBI's most wanted flyer at the post office. Rodney's gig was up. He was arrested and extradited to California, where he would finally be charged with the attack on the 8-year-old girl. It took 3 whole years before Rodney was finally charged and behind bars for attempting to take the life of Tali Shapiro. Because Tali was still a child, her family didn't want her to testify and go through her entire ordeal again, which is totally understandable. But that meant that Rodney got off with a lesser charge after they had no primary witness to testify. In prison, Rodney entered into the indeterminate sentencing program, which was quite popular at the time. You know what that means. Reduced sentences for good behavior. So Rodney got out after serving only 17 months for literally trying to take the life of an 8-year-old. And literally 2 months after his release, he was rearrested for attacking a 13-year-old girl in the exact same way. And they yeet that guy right back into prison. This time, Rodney ended up serving 2 years before he was paroled again for showing evidence of rehabilitation. Rodney asked his parole officer if he could visit relatives in New York, and the officer made the choice to allow flight risk Rodney to hop on over to the Big Apple, where he immediately disappeared. 7 days after Rodney arrived, he claimed his next victim, 23-year-old college student Ellen Jane Hover, whose remains wouldn't be found until 11 months later. Despite his ever-growing body count, Rodney applied and got a job at the Los Angeles freaking Times as a typesetter in 1978. He didn't even use a false name. He literally used the name Rodney Alcala. He had this long criminal record, and you're telling me he still gets hired over other prospects? Rodney typed by day. And by night, he would lure young girls into his apartment under the ruse that they'd be a part of his portfolio for his professional photography. While some girls simply had their pictures taken and left, others were never heard from again. 17-year-old Leanne Leadham, one of the lucky ones who got away, remembered how odd it was when Rodney showed him his portfolio, which was mostly photos of teenage men without their orange peels on. I guess he'd also proudly show his photography to his co-workers at the Times as well. And while people thought it was strange and creepy, no one ever spoke up or said anything. Police actually released Rodney's portfolio of the young victims in order to identify them, which are still available to view today. A lot of people have come forward over the years to identify themselves, which has helped investigators grasp how many people got away, and more importantly, how many didn't. During his stint at the Los Angeles Times, he actually got interviewed by the Hillside Stranglers Task Force. He ended up being ruled out as a suspect, but that didn't stop him from still getting arrested during the investigation and serving a brief stint in jail for some Mary Jane possession. When he was released from jail in June of 1978, he became a contestant on the popular reality show The Dating Game, where he was introduced by the host as a successful photographer who got his start when his father found him in the darkroom at the age of 13, fully developed. Even though Rodney technically won his episode, criminal profilers believe that Cheryl's rejection of him backstage was a serious hit to his ego and could have been a factor in motivating his crimes further. And in June of 1979, 12-year-old Robin Samso from Huntington Beach disappeared on her way to ballet class. When her body was found 12 days later in the Los Angeles foothills, Robin's friends told police that a stranger came up to them on the beach and asked to take their pictures. The girls described the man, and after detectives circulated a sketch of the photographer, Rodney's parole officer recognized him. The cops searched Rodney's mom's house in Monterey Park and found a rental receipt for a storage locker in Seattle. In the locker, they found Robin's earrings. And with that, Rodney was arrested in July and held without bail until he was tried, convicted, and sentenced to lethal injection in 1980. But his conviction was overturned by the California Supreme Court due to the trial judge allowing the jury to hear his prior predatory attacks on the young women. By some legal loophole, Rodney got out. In 1986, Rodney went back to court and was convicted for the second time in Robin's case. Big surprise there. And then in 2001, a court of appeals panel overthrew his conviction again. The reason was in the second trial, the judge did not allow a witness to back up the defense's claim that the park ranger who had found the body of Robin had been hypnotized by police investigators. Robin's brother, Robert, remarked that he felt like Rodney was the victor and that the criminal justice system had absolutely failed him, while giving Rodney all the chances in the world. He also noted that inmates on the row had the legal right to study the law, and Rodney had 30 years to do so. But then in 2003, the shiitake finally hit the fan. A deputy who wanted to re-prosecute Rodney got a call from his boss, saying they got a saliva sample from Rodney in prison and got two hits in the system. His DNA was linked to two Los Angeles women whose bodies were left in unsettling poses. The first woman was 27-year-old Georgia Wixted, a nurse found in her Malibu bedroom in 1977. The other was 32-year-old Charlotte Lamb, a Santa Monica legal secretary found in El Segundo in 1978. And now they're excited to see just how many more matches they were gonna get. Orange and Los Angeles County PD started to work together on the case. And in 2004, they got another hit on a case from 1977 when a teen runaway's body was found on a dirt road in Mulholland Drive. Rodney took the insanity plea for the slayings of Georgia, Charlotte, the teen runaway, as well as two other bodies his DNA had been found on, but has since changed his mind to maintain that he is not guilty of any of these cases. He also continued to deny that he took Robin. But with the facade falling away, the police determined Rod was along the likes of Ted Bundy. He was smart, charming, easy on the eyes, and truly thought he could figure his way out of anything. But with the power of forensic science on their side, these guys had Rodney cornered. But he was all like, no one puts Rodney in a corner. While he waited for his third trial, Rodney wrote and self-published a book called You, the Jury, where he claimed his innocence in Robin's case and suggested a different suspect. He was also quite the jailhouse lawyer, apparently. Rodney, to date, has filed over 24 different lawsuits in order to try and win money, some of which have included: the county jail refused to provide him a low-fat diet, he was denied television, he was denied his subscription to Playboy magazine, and that he did not get candy bars on Thanksgiving when he saw other inmates get some. In 2003, the Supreme Court ruled to combine the case of Robin and the four newly discovered victims. And 7 years later, in 2010, Rodney walked into the courtroom of his third trial. Rodney, like many maniacal monsters before him, decided to be his own attorney. Rodney took the stand, and for 5 hours, he pretended to interrogate himself and then answer the questions as himself. No joke, he would literally say, "Mr. Alcala, blah, blah, blah," in this deep voice, and then he would turn and be like, "That's a great question, blah, blah, blah," in his own voice, as if he was two different people. He claimed he was at Knott's Berry Farm applying for a job when Robin was kidnapped, and also showed them clips of his episode on the dating game to try to prove that Robin's earrings found in the storage locker were actually his, and that he wore them on his episode. Despite heavily focusing on his innocence in Robin's case, he didn't really make an effort to dispute the other four charges and said he didn't remember them. And then, a surprise witness took the stand. His first victim. That's right, Tali Shapiro testified against the man who attacked her 42 years ago. Despite her parents not allowing her to testify as a child, Tali was able to look her attacker in the eye as a grown woman and finally share to the public her side of the story. Rodney chose not to question Tali during the trial and muttered a lame apology to her for his despicable behavior. Tali didn't even acknowledge this apology and merely said she should have been his first and his last victim, not the first of many. As part of his closing argument, he played a song called Alice's Restaurant by Arlo Guthrie. And despite that banger of a closer, he was found guilty in the first degree on all 5 charges. In March of 2010, Rodney was sentenced to judicial execution once again. But this wasn't the end for Rodney, because soon after he was tied to 2 more cold cases from the 70s in New York that he pleaded guilty to in 2013, and he received an additional 25 years to life on his sentence. Psychiatric experts have proposed that Rodney suffers from narcissistic personality disorder, borderline personality disorder, malignant narcissism, psychopathy, and sadism, but they insist that he definitely still knows right from wrong. He just doesn't care. Today, 78-year-old Rodney Alcala sits in a California prison while awaiting his execution.